In this video, we'll look at how to place a cloth object interactively and how to squeeze the most quality out of the simulation, even if your computer is very old or very cheap, as well as some other tips for how to get the best results with the cloth simulation in Blender. And you can find the files for this, as well as some visual examples of some tests I did with different values for the cloth simulation options in my Blender Secrets ebook. So first of all, create a collision object. So I'm going to use a cube, scale it down on the Z axis, and then I'm going to shift and right click on top of it so that I can place the 3D cursor there and add a grid or a plane. I'm going to use a grid because it's basically a plane that is already subdivided, and then we're going to subdivide it maybe two more times. So we have quite a lot of subdivisions, and that's always important when you have cloth so that it has enough geometry to move. And I'm just going to select one of these vertices. It doesn't really matter, but maybe it's easier to select one in the middle. And then I'm going to go here to the vertex groups and click on the plus icon to add a vertex group. And then click on assign. And that's basically assigned this one vertex to this vertex group. So if I deselect everything now with Alt-A and click on select, then it will select that one vertex. And if you look at weight paint mode, you'll see that it has weight painted that one vertex. And then with this vertex still selected, I'm going to press Ctrl-H and then hook to new object. And this has created an empty. Let me just show you in wireframe mode and X-ray mode so you can see it. It's basically an empty, but it is in this case a hook. And what a hook does is it allows you to grab a vertex and move it around in object mode instead of in edit mode. So let's go to object mode. And so I've moved this grid slightly above this cube. And to make it a bit more easy to see, I'm just going to turn this to a matcap. I'm just going to use any one of these is fine, maybe this one. And then we're going to set the colors to random. You could also choose objects and then just set a color per object. So go to this tab here and then viewport display. And then here under color, you can just choose any color you want. So I can give this one another color. So now it's more clear what we're doing. And so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to select this green box and I'm going to here in this tab here, and I'm going to click on collision, and that just turns this into a collision object. And what that means is that cloth sims and other kinds of simulations can now collide with this object. And this one is also going to be some kind of physics object, but in this case, we'll click on cloth. So we turn this into a cloth object. And now to use the vertex group that we made before, we're going to go here under shape. And then when it says pin group, you're going to click on that empty field and choose a group. And that is the vertex group that we made before. So that's that one vertex. And a pin group is basically a vertex group where the vertices are pinned. So they are stuck in space and they cannot move with the cloth simulation. But we can move it by using the hook that we added and then moving that vertex around. And one more thing we need to enable here is self-collisions. Otherwise, the cloth will kind of self-intersect and that will look unrealistic, of course. And for the rest, I'm just going to leave these settings as is. And so now you can see in the modifiers, we have the hook modifier and we have the cloth modifier. And so now all we need to have is a timeline. And by default, you will have a timeline, but I removed it from my default Blender setup. So I have to edit again. And I'm going to make this slightly longer, like 10,000 frames. Otherwise, the simulation will keep looping back after a few seconds. And I want to be able to experiment with it. And so now what we can do is we can press the play button here, and that starts the simulation. And then I can grab this empty, this hook empty, by clicking on it. And then with G, I can move it around. And to make this look a little bit better, we can select the cloth and use shade smooth. So right click and choose shade smooth. And then I'm going to add a subdiff modifier. I can either do that by pressing Ctrl-1 or by just clicking on add modifier, search, and then searching for the subdivision surface modifier. And it's here at the bottom. So it's doing its thing after all of the other modifiers. And so let me just go back to the beginning by clicking on this back button here. And let me just move the hook around. So as you can see now, I can move this and place this cloth anywhere I want. And for me to be able to not intersect with this, let me just click on the pause button and go back one more time. So one very useful keyboard shortcut is when you're moving something, you can press Shift and Z. And what that does is, so G to move, and then Shift and Z. And now I have locked the Z axis. So Shift Z locks the Z axis. So now I'm just moving it on the X and Y planes. And the reason it stopped after 250 frames, you can see there's this kind of blue bar. And this blue bar here is the cache for the simulation. And so even though we have a long timeline, we have to extend the cache. So with the plane selected, I go here to this simulation tab. And then the cloud settings under cache, we can also set this to as long as our timeline. And so now when we go back to the beginning and press the play button, then we can play with this for 10,000 frames. And I'm going to press Shift Z again so that it's constrained on the Z axis. And let me just do that one more time. And first I'll move this back to where it was. So I'll press play, G, Shift Z, and now I can move this around all the way I want. And this is useful for when you're doing an architectural visualization, for example, and you need to place some towel in a tasteful position on a sofa, for example, or on the edge of a bed. Then you can do that like this. So again, I can move it if I want to have it over here instead. So G and Shift and Z. And then when I'm happy with that, I can press the pause button and let stop it playing. And now if I want to apply this, so if I don't want this to be a simulation anymore, I can just select the object in object mode, press Ctrl A, and then choose Visual Geometry to Mesh. And that will just turn it into geometry, as you can see. To make this look better, we can use some sculpting. So we already had the cloth brush for a while, but since Blender 4.3, I think what they've done is they've taken the kind of obscure options that most people didn't know about, and they've split the one cloth brush up into several different ones with those different options enabled. And where you find it is in sculpt mode, you click here and then you go to simulation. And now we have all of these different options to choose from. One thing that we should pay attention to is, for example, if I click on drag cloth and I drag this, as you can see, we don't really have enough resolution in our mesh yet. So let me just undo that a few times. If you add a multi-res modifier and you subdivide this a couple of times, I find that the result is not really very good. Let's go down one level and let's try a different brush. I find that with multi-res, it is quite difficult to do the cloud sculpting. So let me just remove that one. And in fact, what I prefer to do is in object mode, add one level of subdivision and then just apply that modifier. So now we have this amount of subdivision, so 25,600 faces. And let's try some sculpting again. And you can change the radius by pressing F. And now it's way too strong, so let me just undo that and reduce the strength to about 0.1. And now I have a lot more control. Now I can start adding some finer folds like this by just bunching folds together. So let's try the expand contract cloth brush. And let's see what that does. So that just adds some general wrinkles here and there. And you can always press Shift and then just blur things out again. Another really fun brush to use is the grab planar cloth brush. So if we select that, and let's also set the strength fairly low, then we can just kind of move these together. So again, you get this kind of bunched up effect. And by pushing this up, we can also get some more folds there. Push this in this direction. And again, if we think that's too much, then we can always smooth it out. And yeah, this brush is really fun for just sort of pushing things in a certain direction and seeing those folds be created. And yeah, if it's too much, just undo or Alt Shift to smooth it out. So now we have quite a bunch more folds. And maybe I'll push this over here. Now with the default quality settings, it's pretty easy to move this around on my computer. But if I set this to the maximum, so the maximum is 80, and in the collisions it's 20, then if I try to simulate this, it will go very, very, very slowly and my computer cannot handle it. So what do you do if you do want to have high quality and you want to be able to also control it? Well, first of all, let's set this back to the default values. And what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to turn off the cloth modifier for a moment. So I'm just going to click on this icon so we don't see it. And then I'm going to enable auto keying here. And I'll select my empty and press play. And then I can just move the empty to wherever I want and press the pause key and then disable auto keying. Very important. And so you see now we have these keyframes for my empty. And so now what I can do is I can turn the cloth modifier back on and go to the cloth panel. And I can increase the quality as high as I want and increase the collision quality as well. And then I simply click on bake and then I wait for a moment. And as you can see, it's very slowly calculating this. And so now when you see this blue line in the timeline, it means that the cache here is baked. And so now we can just script through and it's not actually simulating anything. It's just showing what's cached. And I like to work this way with a recorded empty and then just baking everything. Because that way you can test out different settings. And let me just delete all bakes that frees up the bake. And then we can go back to the first frame. And now I can start experimenting. Like for example, what will happen if I add 1 kilo of vertex mass? And then I will bake again. And now it's finished baking. So we can check what the result is. And we can find a good frame like this, for example. And it does look quite different than when we had our vertex mass as 0.3, which is the default. I find that vertex mass is the setting that has the most influence on how the result looks, and also the air viscosity. So these two physical properties here are very important. I have experimented with all of these other values. However, I generally only see very, very subtle differences. So it's not really worth experimenting with, in my opinion. Those are the values that I would experiment with for the cloth object, but for the collision object, you can also try experimenting with the friction value. So let's say we set this to 50, for example, and we try to bake that again. So let's play the result. And you can see that the cloth object really has a lot of friction, so it cannot slide so easily along this collision object. And so that's controlled with this friction value. Another thing you want to keep in mind with cloth simulations is the size of the cloth object, as well as the amount of geometry it has. So in this case, if we go into edit mode, we can see that it has 1,600 faces. And I think this is a very reasonable amount. It's not too little, but it's also not too much. And if it was double this, I think the simulation would have problems. And the way it looks when it has problems in Blender is it will kind of crunch up, it will shrivel up. And that happens also if the object has a small size. So if the object, the cloth object has a small size, it can also tend to like shrivel up. And the way to solve that is simply by scaling it up in object mode. And conversely, if you scale it up too much, it will also react differently. So you really need to work with something that is not too big and not too small. Those are all the tips I have today about the cloth modifier, but if you have some suggestion or some questions about it, please feel free to leave a comment. And thanks for watching all the way until the end.